On the News Hour tonight, 1 million species at risk. The United Nations lays out how humans are accelerating the extinction of species across the planet. Then, a dual look at rising tensions. North Korea launches a test missile, and the U.S. moves an aircraft carrier into the Persian Gulf sooner than expected. Plus, Amy Walter and Tamara Keith join us to analyze a busy weekend of campaigning by the 2020 presidential hopefuls. And masterworks by artist Jean-Michel Basquiat, now on display in the neighborhood where he got his start, New York's East Village.
Unlike a lot of us who were just here experimenting with art and our voice as artists, Basquiat knew early on, before any of us, that he was going to be famous.
All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by economy for 160 years. BNSF, the engine that connects us.
Babbel, a language program that teaches real-life conversations in a new language, such as Spanish, French, German, Italian, and more. Babbel's 10 to 15-minute lessons are available as an app or online. More information on Babbel.com.
Consumer Cellular. Financial services firm, Raymond James. The William and Flora Hewlett Foundation, for more than 50 years, advancing ideas and supporting institutions to promote a better world at Hewlett.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
A million plant and animal species are on the edge of extinction. That's according to a new United Nations report out today on biodiversity. Scientists attributed the unprecedented threat to the, quote, relentless pursuit of economic growth. We'll have more on the devastating impacts human actions are having on nature right after the news summary. The U.S. has deployed an aircraft carrier to the Middle East amid reports Iran was preparing to possibly attack U.S. troops in the region. National Security Advisor John Bolton issued a statement Sunday night saying the U.S. will, quote, send a clear and unmistakable message to the Iranian regime that any attack on the United States' interests will be met with unrelenting force. And today, while in Finland, Secretary of State Mike Pompeo said the U.S. has seen enough evidence to cause concern.
We have continued to see activity that leads us to believe that there's escalation that may be taking place. And so we're taking all the appropriate actions, both from a security perspective and well as our ability to make sure that the president has a wide range of options in the event that something should actually take place.
We'll have more on the U.S. military moves later in the program. Back in this country, a bipartisan group of more than 370 federal prosecutors have signed a statement saying that President Trump would have been charged with obstruction of justice if he were not president. Special Counsel Robert Mueller declined to charge Mr. Trump with obstruction, but he did not exonerate him. Meanwhile, Attorney General William Barr missed today's deadline to hand over Mueller's full, unredacted report on his Russia investigation. The House Judiciary Committee will vote Wednesday on whether to hold Barr in contempt of Congress. President Trump's former personal lawyer, Michael Cohen, reported to federal prison in New York today. He was sentenced to 3 years for lying to Congress and for violating campaign finance law by arranging hush money payments for two women who claimed to have had affairs with Mr. Trump. Cohen took one final swipe at his former boss as he was swarmed by reporters outside his New York City apartment today.
Guys, hold on, Michael. Give us a second.
My family and friends, that the country will be in a place without xenophobia, injustice, and lies at the helm of our country. There still remains much to be told, and I look forward to the day that I can share the truth.
Cohen cooperated with the Mueller probe and with separate ongoing state investigations into the Trump Organization and into spending on the president's inauguration. And late today, the Treasury Department denied a request from House Democrats to release President Trump's tax returns. Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin said the request lacked a legitimate legislative purpose. Investigators in Russia are trying to piece together what caused a plane to crash land in Moscow yesterday and burst into flames, killing at least 41 people. Survivors fled for their lives as smoke billowed from the Aeroflot plane. Investigators recovered the jet's flight recorders, but haven't yet been able to pinpoint the cause of the disaster.
Investigators are looking at different versions of the incident, that the pilot and other staff were underqualified, that the plane was broken, and bad weather conditions.
Russian media reported that the pilot said the plane lost radio communications after it was struck by lightning. And there was a tense calm in Gaza today after Hamas announced a ceasefire deal with the Israeli government. Violence over the weekend killed nearly 30 people. It was the deadliest fighting since the 2014 war. Some Palestinians began the Muslim holy month of Ramadan among ruins as families buried some of the 25 who died. Most were civilians. The Israeli government claimed its strikes targeted militants. Palestinian rockets also killed 4 Israeli civilians. Turkey's top election board today voided the victory of an opposition candidate in Istanbul's mayoral election and ordered a new vote for June 23rd. President Recep Tayyip Erdogan's party had challenged the legitimacy of the election after it narrowly lost. Turkey's main opposition party said today's ruling amounted to, quote, plain dictatorship. On Wall Street today, concerns over an escalation in the U.S. trade war with China pushed stocks lower, a day after President Trump threatened to impose more tariffs on Chinese goods. The Dow Jones Industrial Average lost 66 points to close at 26,438. The NASDAQ fell more than 40 points, and the S&P 500 slipped 13. And a new royal baby has been born. Meghan, the Duchess of Sussex, gave birth to a baby boy early this morning. Well-wishers gathered outside Windsor Castle, holding signs and balloons and drinking champagne to celebrate the news. Prince Harry told reporters they'll share the baby's name in the coming days.
It's been the most amazing experience I could ever possibly imagine. How any woman does what they do is beyond comprehension, but we're both absolutely thrilled and so grateful to all the love and support for everybody out there.
Their baby is the 7th in line to the British throne and is Queen Elizabeth's 8th great-grandchild. Still to come on the NewsHour, the devastating effects humans may have on up to 1 million species. A look at the recent military activity involving Iran and North Korea. Amy Walter and Tamara Keith on the race for 2020 and much more. Mother Nature is under threat from human activity as never before. More species are now threatened with extinction than at any other point in human history. That grim assessment comes from a sweeping new report issued by a panel of experts convened by the United Nations. Among its findings, nearly a quarter of plant and animal species are threatened, many within decades. That includes more than 40% of amphibian species and more than a third of marine mammals. Much of this is caused by human activity, farming and fishing and mining, as well as the use of fossil fuels that contribute to pollution and climate change. It's led to forests being cut down and agricultural land being degraded, making large parts of the world less able to grow food. The report says that more than a third of fish stocks are being pulled out of the oceans at unsustainable levels. To better understand what's happening, I spoke earlier today with one of the many authors of the report. Patricia Balvanera is with the National University of Mexico. We spoke from Paris, where the report's findings were issued, and I began by asking what she saw as the most striking part of the report.
And what is really amazing is not only that a million species are being threatened, but also that the impacts of these laws really trickles down to so many dimensions and to so many people on Earth.
I know you've been studying this for a while, but did the severity of these results surprise you?
So the report indicates that 1 million species are being threatened. And we are talking about a wide range of species. We have known for a while that, for instance, large vertebrates, no, like lions and elephants have been threatened, or we all have heard about the bears. We recently have information of how insects are declining. And I remember when I was a kid, when every time we had a trip in the car, the windshield was full of insects. But this is not true anymore. Why should I care about not having insects? Well, a large fraction of agricultural production depends on these tiny insects that pollinate the flowers, and then that produce the fruits. So almonds, apples, an important contribution to tomatoes depend on these pollinators. And we are really not aware of how this is having a huge impact in agricultural productivity, for example.
This report points the finger very directly at us, at human activity on the planet. Can you give us more detail about what it is that we're actually doing that's driving these changes?
Yes, let me give you an example. One of the main drivers of change in nature is the change of how we use the land or the sea. So for instance, we are transforming 75% of the land on Earth for production of food, production of crops, production of cattle mainly. And this is 75% of the land. So what does it mean? We can produce more food. Actually, the value of crops has increased by three times since 1970, but what we have eroded the potential of nature to support this productivity. And so the land is degraded, biodiversity is degraded, so we will not be able to continue producing food at the same rate because we have eroded that ability to provide food.
We know we can address climate change by moving to renewable types of energy, but with things like farming and fishing and mining, can those things be done in a different way that doesn't threaten so many species?
There's very different ways to produce food. So today we use the language of mainstreaming biodiversity into agriculture, into fisheries, into forestry, into tourism. And this means producing food from agriculture, fisheries, for example, in a way that is friendly with biodiversity. So for instance, in Mexico, where I come from, there are very diverse crop systems where you have maize, beans, squash, and up to 10 or 20 species in the same plot. And so this produces probably a slightly lower yield, but a huge diversity of crop foods, and also in a much more secure way. Even if the climate is drier or colder, there will be many things to eat, even if at the cost of a slightly lower yield.
But those activities are done this way now because the people and the nations who do them think it's in their economic interest to do this, meaning there's going to be big incentives to maintain business as usual.
Absolutely. So what we were able to show in the report is that the global economy has grown four times, trade has grown 10 times, and that per capita consumption is very unequal. People in more developed countries consume up to four times more than people in least developed countries. So there are very strong interests against changing the way we produce, and very particularly a large fraction of agricultural production or fisheries or forestry production is in the hand of a few very large corporations. But it doesn't mean by being large, they're not interested in making change. So by talking directly to these very large corporations, it is possible to make some of these changes possible.
Sir Robert Watson, who is the chairman of this panel, said, "We are eroding the very foundations of our economies, livelihoods, food security, health, and quality of life worldwide." I don't mean to sound overly dramatic about this, but he's describing this as a threat to our very way of life. Do you see it the same way?
Yeah, so the most striking headline is that the life support system provided by nature that is really holding all the needs of humanity and all the organisms living in Earth is deeply threatened. So this means there's a threat to our everyday life, to our economies, to our well-being.
All right. Patricia Balvaniera of the National University of Mexico, thank you very much.
It was my pleasure. Thank you so much to all of you.
This weekend saw new and somewhat foreboding developments relating to two flashpoints of American foreign policy, Iran and North Korea. We'll get to North Korea and its missile launch in a moment. But first, last night, an unusual statement from National Security Advisor John Bolton announced that a carrier strike group was being moved into the Persian Gulf because of unspecified threatening actions by Iran. Here to unpack all of this is Foreign Affairs correspondent Nick Schifrin. Welcome. So the U.S. says we've got this response we have to have against Iran. What is exactly are we deploying there?
So you mentioned it, a carrier strike group. This is the USS Abraham Lincoln and about a half dozen other ships. And the carrier strike group that sails together really is one of the most visible and potent, frankly, aspects of U.S. military might. Alongside that is a bomber task force, a collection of B-1 or B-52 bombers. And what we saw from the National Security Advisor, John Bolton, in that unusual statement last night, and by the way, it's unusual not only when it came out, but also the fact that the National Security Advisor announced military movements like this. He said this was designed to send a clear and unmistakable message that any attack will be met with, quote, unrelenting force. So military officials I spoke to today say that the Abraham Lincoln carrier strike group was on the way to the Middle East, but this advanced that by a few weeks, so they'll get there earlier. And the Air Force officials we spoke to today say they're still figuring out exactly which planes will get there when, but this will increase their lethality in the region. So bottom line, as one military official put this, this is a significant and important deterrence against Iran. And as one regional diplomat told me, this is really a new phase in the U.S. campaign against Iran in the region.
As you mentioned, John Bolton and Mike Pompeo over the last few days have said, we've got this evidence that Iran is up to something and that's why we have to act. What evidence are they citing?
So the U.S. officials I'm speaking to cite a few things generally. They say that these are threats to U.S. assets in the region, specifically the Persian Gulf, and to U.S. allies, Saudi Arabia, the United Arab Emirates, and those are two countries that Iran has threatened for working with the United States as part of the U.S.'s maximum pressure campaign against Iran. The Pentagon spokesman, Charles Summers, came out just a few hours ago and said specifically that there's heightened Iranian readiness to conduct offensive operations against U.S. forces. So there's also a threat against U.S. forces, according to the Pentagon.
Has there been any criticism of this move?
There are a few criticisms. I spoke with many Iran experts today, and they specifically said they're not sure they can trust John Bolton, the National Security Advisor, when he cites this intelligence. Bolton has been criticized in the past for manipulating intelligence, including by some of his allies. And also, he has consistently talked about regime change in Iran. And that leads to criticism number two. Javad Zarif, the Iranian foreign minister, has talked about the U.S. increasing the chances of confrontation. And some Democratic senators came out today and said, this is a drumbeat to war. We worry that the administration is repeating what the U.S. did before Iraq in 2003. The U.S. says, the administration says, the people I'm talking to say, and Bolton specifically says, we are not looking for war. The Pentagon said today, we are not looking for war. But the fact is, the tensions are increasing, and the U.S. is increasing its military presence in the region.
I mean, we know that from day one of the Trump administration, they have been, as you say, exerting a maximum force campaign against Iran. Given that, where does this recent move fit into that context?
So this will be 1 year, almost exactly, on Wednesday, that the U.S. pulled out of the Iran deal. In the last month, the U.S. has labeled Iran's Revolutionary Guard Corps, the RGC, a terrorist organization, and it has sanctioned every country in the world that will continue to import Iranian oil. The U.S. says that this maximum pressure is to try to get Iran to the table again, and or to really significantly weaken the government and the economy. So far, Iran has not responded to any of these in any kind of dramatic way, and it is still abiding by the restrictions imposed on it by the nuclear deal. But what U.S. officials are worried about right now is that Iran may decide to take a dramatic step or even perhaps a violent response in the region. And U.S. and European officials are talking about fearing that Iran will restart one of its enrichment programs, possibly. And so this is a tense moment. And frankly, William, it's going to get even tenser. U.S. officials tell me they will impose more sanctions on Iran on Wednesday. Iran is promising to unveil some kind of response or some kind of new announcement on Wednesday for the Iran nuclear deal anniversary. And so we are in a cycle of confrontation right now.
Okay, let's shift gears a little bit. North Korea, late Friday night, we saw them launch a missile. This coming in the context, of course, of these repeated Trump-Kim summits where we're trying to denuclearize that country. How significant is that launch from Friday?
So U.S. officials tell me this is not a new missile. And you heard from the president this weekend over Twitter and his senior aides all weekend saying that, look, this is not a big deal. They downplayed it. And they downplayed it because they said it's not an ICBM, not an intercontinental ballistic missile. Therefore, it couldn't threaten the United States. And therefore, it also wasn't a break of Kim Jong-un's promise not to test an ICBM. But there's a lot of buts. This is the first launch in more than 500 days, so it's significant just in and of itself. Even if this missile can't threaten the U.S., it can threaten U.S. allies like Japan and South Korea. And it is a violation, by the way, of U.N. Security Council resolutions. And it may not break Kim Jong-un's promise not to test ICBMs, but it does break his promise not to increase tensions with South Korea. And that is a promise that he has made.
So what message is North Korea trying to send with this launch?
There's an internal message to its own people and also to officials who might be skeptical of diplomacy with the United States that we can still be tough. And there's an external message. One is expressing frustration and also sending a warning. The North Koreans have been upset by U.S.-South Korean exercises, including using a surface-to-air defense platform called THAAD that was recently done. And they're also upset there's been no diplomatic progress. The president walked away from the table basically in Hanoi saying that the deal that North Korea was offering was not good enough. And North Korean experts we spoke to today told us the message is that North Korea wants some diplomatic movement. North Korea still has a robust weapons program and is trying to remind the U.S. of that, and a reminder of the U.S. that the North Koreans still have military options moving forward.
Nick Schifrin, thanks for bringing us up to speed.
Thank you.
Stay with us. Coming up on the News Hour, an uptick in xenophobia in South Africa as Election Day approaches. Speaking with philanthropist Melinda Gates about her new book, The Moment of Lift. Plus, the work of artist Jean-Michel Basquiat, now on display in New York's East Village. As the list of Democrats running for president now tops more than 20, candidates again hit early primary states this weekend. Lisa Desjardins will get the take from our Politics Monday duo in a moment. But first, Yamiche Alcindor brings us up to speed on the latest from the campaign trail.
In South Carolina, chants of We Want Joe. This weekend, former Vice President Joe Biden made his first campaign stop in the state. In Columbia, he set out to directly appeal to black voters. He denounced the, quote, legacy of systemic racism and referenced his former boss, President Barack Obama.
As Barack says, you know, when two equally qualified people, one Jamal and one John, they both apply for a job and John gets the job. That's a reality in America.
In the early voting state of South Carolina, unlike Iowa and New Hampshire, the majority of Democratic primary voters are black. South Bend, Indiana Mayor Pete Buttigieg also rallied in South Carolina over the weekend. Sunday at a high school, he spoke to a crowd in North Charleston. He later acknowledged that he needs better outreach to black voters. The mayor has made faith a cornerstone of his campaign, Earlier on Sunday in Georgia, he attended former President Jimmy Carter's Sunday school. In Iowa, Vermont Senator Bernie Sanders crisscrossed the state in a series of rallies. He pushed back on Vice President Biden, once saying Biden has the most progressive record in the race. In an interview with ABC's This Week, Sanders didn't hold back.
Joe voted for the war in Iraq. I led the effort against it. Joe voted for NAFTA and permanent normal trade relations, trade agreements with China. I led the effort against that. If you look at Joe's record and you look at my record, I don't think there's much question about who's more progressive.
A host of other candidates also campaigned in Iowa this weekend, including Massachusetts Senator Elizabeth Warren, Minnesota Senator Amy Klobuchar, and former Representative Beto O'Rourke of Texas. Meanwhile, at an NAACP event in Detroit, Kamala Harris went after President Trump's rhetoric.
Let's speak truth here and today. This president isn't trying to make America great. He's trying to make America hate.
Today, New Jersey Senator Cory Booker released a sweeping gun control agenda with more than 24 policy proposals. One would require all gun owners to be licensed by the federal government.
In a statement, Booker said, quote, I am sick and tired of hearing thoughts and prayers for the communities that have been shattered by gun violence. It is time for bold action. With more than 20 candidates vying for 20 spots in the first Democratic debates in June, presidential hopefuls are trying to break through to voters. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Yamiche Alcindor.
That is a lot to take in. Thank goodness it is time for Politics Monday to help. I'm joined by Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report and host of Politics with Amy Walter on WNYC Radio, and Tamara Keith of NPR. She co-hosts the NPR Politics podcast. Thank you both. Let's just jump right into this. Amy, I think Democrats have now gotten past large field. I don't know, epic,
we're
biblical.
Into, yes.
Why
mammoth.
Is this field not just large, but extra large?
There are a whole lot of reasons. We could spend the next hour talking about why the field is as big as it is. I mean, the most obvious is, look how successful Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump were in 2016, two candidates that nobody gave any shot of getting where, how far they got in the process. So there's certainly a sense of, well, if they could do it, I could do it. But I think there's also a sense among a lot of Democrats that beating Donald Trump is so important. It's beyond just putting a Democrat in the White House, that they see Donald Trump as essentially an existential threat to the country, and that they want to be the one that can make sure that the right candidate is there to beat him. So finding the perfect candidate to beat Donald Trump is more important now than ever. And finally, I think that the party, which used to play a really big role in helping to narrow the field and thin the field, well, it doesn't have much power anymore, especially now that people can raise a whole bunch of money with these things, right, these smartphones, and they can bypass the traditional money gatekeepers. It can keep people in the race a lot longer.
Yeah, one thing I would just add is that in 2016, Jeb Bush on the Republican side came out and he wanted to have this sort of shock and awe. Right. He was going to have all this money and scare away the rest of the field. And he didn't. There was a historically large field running in 2016 on the Republican side. Well, part of what this 22, 21, 24-person field on the Democratic side tells me is that there's no single candidate that is scaring everyone else out of the field. Everyone thinks that they have a chance. This really says that no one was afraid that Joe Biden was going to run for president and didn't run because of it. In fact, a huge number of people are running for president, and they believe that they have a shot.
It's interesting, Tam, as we heard in Yamiche's report, there's a lot of attention on South Carolina. You said no single candidate is scaring the field. I wonder if no single state is owning the field. Why is South Carolina and why are African-American voters in particular getting so much love?
Well, they are important in the primary, certainly. African-American voters are very well represented among Democrats in important states like South Carolina, which is an early state, Latino voters in Nevada, another early state. Then you get to California, which is this big, diverse state. And then also what Hillary Clinton found when she was running in 2016 is that she was able to win in all of these southern states with large African-American populations on the Democratic side. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of candidates are looking and saying, okay, maybe Iowa and New Hampshire are not my state, but if I can just make it past Iowa and New Hampshire, there are other states where maybe they will have more appeal or they'll be able to be better represented. And also, those very same voters are also a critical part of the Democratic electorate in the general election.
Yeah, and remember, South Carolina is important. It comes on a Saturday. 3 days later is Super Tuesday. So beyond just being the place where you have, for the first time, a majority of voters that are African American, it is a momentum to take you into Super Tuesday, which has over 1,690 delegates up for grabs on Super Tuesday. Many of the states on Super Tuesday also have overwhelmingly diverse electorates. It's California, it's Texas, it's Alabama, Arkansas, Georgia, North Carolina. So doing really well in South Carolina sets you up really well because you sort of have to turn right on a dime to go into a lot of big states where you're not going to have a whole lot of time to introduce yourself.
And I've got a soft spot for the politics of South Carolina. They are never boring. Yeah.
And food.
And food, that's right. Now, Amy, I want to ask you earlier in the show, Nick Schifrin reported on two big flashpoints in the world, just two of the several flashpoints, in this case, North Korea and Iran. But we don't see voters responding to foreign policy in polls. Why is that not really an issue in this campaign? And what are issues for voters right now?
So I think back in 2008, foreign policy was a big issue because the Iraq War was so unpopular and there was a clear dividing line between Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton on who supported the war. And so that made that a big issue. Now we don't have that same issue dominating the issue set for voters, Democrat or Republican. Instead, what we're finding is what Democrats are really, really concerned about. There's a poll that just came out today, NBC Wall Street Journal. Overwhelming top issue for Democrats, healthcare. Overwhelming top issue for Republicans, immigration, not surprising. Those are the things that are taking up most of the oxygen. When we look more broadly, it's healthcare and jobs and the economy that are the top two issues.
Tam, what do you see?
Yeah, and this is just something that people, regular people in America that these candidates are coming into contact with on a regular basis, they just aren't asking about right. foreign policy. And not to go back to 2016 again and again, but I was following Hillary Clinton's campaign. She is a former Secretary of State. She could talk about foreign policy until she is blue and she'd still have more to say. And yet she did not talk about it very often on the trail and she was almost never asked about it in her town halls.
Right. Quickly, as we wrap up, I'm interested, looking back at this huge field, it feels like there's so many right now. How many of these folks are actually going to make it to 2020, do you think?
Right. Even, well, I looked back in 2016, again, as Tam said, there was a really big field, 16 candidates. Five of them dropped out before 2016, so throughout the 2015 year. These debates are going to be very important, who gets on the stage, how well they do. At some point, you know, you need money and you need attention. And even if you have the greatest of intentions, you can't stay in if you don't have those two things.
Debates start in June. How big are those going to be?
Oh, well, I mean, there will be 20 people over two nights. That's literally how big they will be. But I think for a lot of voters, they aren't getting to see these candidates. They're seeing little snippets, and that will be the first big chance for these candidates to introduce themselves beyond sort of viral videos.
And to see them interact with one another.
Yes.
And it'll probably be the first debate where we'll get to see a president live tweet the other party's debates. Wait for it.
There's going to be plenty of tweeting all around.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Thank you. And from you as well, Amy Walter of Cook Political Report, Tamara Keith of NPR. Thank you both. And I want to let our viewers know, join us tomorrow when Judy Woodruff will sit down with Democratic presidential candidate Bernie Sanders right here in our studio. You won't want to miss that.
South Africans will vote in their national election on Wednesday, and there could be a strong challenge to the ruling African National Congress. As special correspondent Fred DeSam Lazaro reports, a new wave of xenophobic attacks has put the issue of immigration front and center.
At this campaign rally for the Economic Freedom Party, once the youth wing of the ruling African National Congress, the frustration was evident.
We are tired of jobless and poverty in our country.
Unemployment in South Africa hovers at 27%, and youth unemployment is nearly double that. It's felt most acutely in the townships, impoverished settlements built under apartheid to segregate the black, Indian, and mixed or colored communities from the minority white population. Sprege Chetty sells used clothes on the side of the road. He lost his factory job years ago, now barely ekes out a living, and he blames, in part, immigrants.
We get a lot of foreigners into the country here, and they've been paid with a less salary. And our local guys that can't get jobs.
That sentiment has provoked spasms of xenophobic violence in recent years. Convenience stores have often been an all-too-convenient target. These stores are largely owned by immigrants today, as are the wholesalers that supply them. Ali Osman, who heads a trade association of Somali businesses, says he is grateful to be in South Africa.
We came with nothing. We have been given the opportunity to conduct businesses, freely move around the country, settle wherever we need to settle. So that is the good part of it.
The bad part, he says, is the violence targeting immigrants, who make up about 3% of the country's 57 million people. Over the past decade, hundreds of immigrants have been injured and dozens killed. Johannesburg's mayor Herman Mashaba says the problem is economic, not xenophobia.
When these foreign nationals come into South Africa, unfortunately because of the economic situation, where do they go? They go into poor communities. And these poor communities, unfortunately, they feel that these people are taking their jobs or whatever.
But many people blame Mashaba himself for inciting violence. The mayor, once an ANC supporter, is now part of the opposition Democratic Alliance. He's blamed many of the city's problems on uncontrolled numbers of undocumented foreigners. This Twitter post was in response to a citizen complaint about poor trash service.
So basically, in his tweet, he implied that the debt is not picked because there are too many migrants. Now,
He's blaming the lack of garbage pickup on too many migrants.
Yes. Government officials, you know, instead of taking accountability for their failures, they then blame the migrants, you know, for the social ills like, you know, crime and lack of housing.
Look at the fine young men that we have here.
Vusumuzi Sibanda is an immigrant from neighboring Zimbabwe, where a collapsing economy and political turmoil have driven many to flee.
Good morning.
Sibanda is suing to get the children among these migrants, most of them undocumented, into public schools. It's their right, he insists, and it's also in the host country's interest.
We are actually creating a situation where these children are either going to become what? Criminals, social misfits, because they have no education. What will they do without an education?
Why do they come?
The migrants come to South Africa for the same reasons that anyone moves, but there are clearly a significant number of people here who are looking for safety.
Professor Lauren Landau says they are fleeing conflict in Somalia, Congo, and elsewhere, but others, including many from South Asia, come to start businesses or ply their skills in the continent's largest economy.
Electricians, builders, others. But we also see a lot of teachers, doctors, medical professionals who are coming in.
Zimbabwe's disintegration dashed any career hopes of people like Fortunate Ndlovu, who once dreamed of becoming a lawyer. Today she shares an immaculate one-room shack with her husband, Mandla Sibanda, and their young son. Together they support at least five family members back in Zimbabwe.
How has it been in South Africa so far?
It's okay because if you go around you can get some piecework.
Some piecework?
Yes.
Ndlovu gets occasional work as a house cleaner. Her husband works in a local restaurant.
We just take anything that comes because half bread is better than nothing at all.
Half a bread is better than nothing?
Yes. We are here to work, only to work, not to go and break the law.
She says immigrants have been unfairly characterized as lawbreakers. Mayor Mashaba, for one, has railed against what he calls rampant criminal activity in the city's immigrant population. But he insists he's not anti-immigrant.
This country, this city of Johannesburg, was built at the back of migrants. But they must come here legally, and when they're here, they must respect our laws. This, for me, is not negotiable.
Clearly, there are criminals among the migrant population. What you see, however, is he sends the police out to find migrant criminals and then parades them as if all of the criminals in towns are migrants. Migrants are no more prone, and in fact, less prone to criminal activity than South African citizens.
But the argument around immigration, echoing those heard in the U.S., are likely to get only louder as Election Day nears. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Fred DeSanlazaro near Johannesburg, South Africa.
Fred's reporting is a partnership with the Undertold Stories Project at the University of St. Thomas in Minnesota. The Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation is the largest private philanthropic foundation in the world. It has an endowment of $50 billion. Its reach has been global, focusing on issues like malaria, reproductive health, family planning, and education. Melinda Gates plays a huge role in shaping the organization's focus. Judy Woodruff spoke with her recently about her new book, which tells what she's learned in that job and her own personal story. It's our latest installment of the NewsHour Bookshelf.
Melinda Gates, welcome. The book is The Moment of Lift, How Empowering Women Changes the World. Thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me, Judy.
So this is your first book, and you weave in your own story with your experiences with women, mostly very, very poor women you've met around the developing world. What did you want to accomplish with this?
Well, I've been meeting men and women around the world now for 20 years of the foundation's work. And so many women have shared the stories of their lives with me. And they really called me to action. And by sharing their story and a bit about my personal journey, I hope to call other people to action for empowering women around the world.
You plunged in the early 1980s into a very male career, dominated career in computer science, and then through the Gates Foundation after you had children. And you write about how it took you a while to find your voice as a woman to advocate for women. Why was that? Why did it take as long as it did, do you think?
Yeah, I think because there's so many things society tells us as women that we should do or we should say or ways we should be. And I was so lucky to grow up with two parents who said to both the two daughters in the family, one of which was me and the two sons, you can be anything you want to be. We could see as a middle-class family it was going to be hard to send us to college, but we could. And I think having a dad who believed in girls in the sciences really helped me see that I could be anything I wanted to be. And so even when I would come up against these barriers in society that women face, I knew that my job was to try and break through those. And in the foundation's work, I didn't originally start with women's issues because I thought those were the soft issues. And I was completely wrong. If we lift up women, they lift up everybody else. But our systems don't always reach women, and there are lots of barriers that hold women down.
And that took a while to understand.
It took a while to understand and to learn, and partly I was hearing it for women all over the world when I'd be out in the developing world talking to women, many different countries in Africa. But I would come back and look at the data, and I always thought data was objective, but data is actually sexist. We don't actually collect a lot of data about women around the world, so we don't actually know that much about their lives. They would often say to me, what about in this little tiny health clinic where I get vaccines for my kids, why can't I get birth control anymore? Why could I get a contraceptive before, and now I can't? And they started to tell me that this was a life and death emergency for their family. And the data actually was very thin about what was going on. But it turned out what the women were telling me was true. This was a life and death emergency in the developing world, and is. 200 million women want contraceptives, and we don't supply them as a world yet.
And speaking of contraceptives and birth control, you are open in the book about your differences with the Catholic Church on these issues, abortion as well. You even take on the church when it comes to leadership roles for women as priests. Do you see any movement in the Catholic Church on these issues?
Well, what I know is that when women have access to contraceptives, they time and space the births of their children. And we know from the longest piece of longitudinal research in global health that those families are healthier, the moms, the babies, the families are better educated, the kids are, and the families are wealthier. And my faith says to me that we believe in loving thy neighbor. And so I have stood up and said what I believe, even with the Catholic Church. The Catholic Church, because of HIV/AIDS, has allowed condoms to be distributed in the developing world. But I have met so many women who have told me, I can't negotiate a condom in the context of my relationship with my husband because I'm either suggesting he's been unfaithful and has AIDS or I've been unfaithful. And so women have to have the types of tools we have here in the United States or the primary tool they want in Africa, which has been in the past delivered and still is in some places, is a shot, which is covert from their husbands.
Has that debate shaken your faith, your personal faith?
I've had to wrestle with my faith, and before I came out publicly in favor of contraceptives. But when I realized that it's because of political pressure in our own country and religious belief that we are letting women die in childbirth, we are letting babies die because a woman has them too soon and too often, my faith tells me that I love these people. And I know I've gotten some beautiful things from the Catholic Church, my roots in social justice, but this is a piece I disagree with the church on.
You don't name President Trump in the book. You speak about our president, our current administration. As you know, this administration is pushing very hard against abortion rights, to limit abortion, make it as restrictive as possible. The question is, why not go farther and call it what it is? Why not name the Trump administration?
Well, I have said that I disagree vehemently with the values being put forward by this administration. So I'm not sure how much stronger I could be. I'm not running for public office, but I disagree. And I disagree in public, and I disagree in private. And our foundation has worked incredibly well with the Bush administration, the Obama administration, Congress in this administration. I don't name this administration in my book because I want it to be a timeless book. I don't name President Bush or former President Obama either. So what I look for are the places where I can move issues forward. And I work with people who are like-minded. Luckily, Congress has held up the foreign aid budget because they know it creates peaceful and prosperous world and societies all over the world.
One other thing I want to ask you about that you write about is your own effort inside your own marriage to find your own voice, to gain self-confidence. And you talk about how you wrestle with whether to even share this publicly.
What is true is that Bill and I always believed in equality. We wanted equality. And what I write about in the book is I didn't even realize that when I came into marriage, we came into marriage, we both came from our own biases of the past, a little bit about how our households operated as kids. And so I surprised Bill when we got pregnant with our first child, Jen. I surprised him and said, I'm going to leave Microsoft. I said, I'm going to leave and raise our kids. And Bill was actually the one who said to me, you know, after Jen was 6 months old, what else are you going to do? Because he knew I had that part of my brain that I also love to work. But yes, those conversations aren't always easy, but I bring them up because we need to have those in our home to make sure that we have equality and to look at what assumptions have we made and do we need to shift those as we have kids or things change or we get older or our careers change. And what I want women to know is you can have full equality and you should in your home, in your workplace, and in your community. And when you do that, it changes the world. Equality makes a huge difference.
Melinda Gates, the book is The Moment of Lift. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Judy.
Finally tonight, more than 30 years after his death, Jean-Michel Basquiat remains one of America's most influential contemporary artists. He carved a unique style that challenged our views of race, poverty, and politics in the U.S. Jeffrey Brown explores a new exhibition showing some of Basquiat's most important work. It's part of our ongoing arts and culture series, Canvas.
New York City's East Village. In the 1970s and 80s, it was known for drugs, crime, homelessness, and a vibrant experimental music and art scene. The heartbeat of it all, Tompkins Square Park.
It was like a real central coming together place. You know, it was a bit of nature in the middle of this teeming city, place where you could crash if you had nowhere to sleep.
Michael Holman is a New York-based artist, writer, filmmaker, and musician, and part of a unique generation of artists who called the East Village home, including Kenny Scharf, Keith Haring, and perhaps most famous of all, Jean-Michel Basquiat.
Jean-Michel Basquiat was, I call him a realized being.
It was at a party in 1979 that Holman first met Basquiat, whose graffiti tag Samo was already well known on the streets of New York.
Did you feel even then a kind of ambition to grow beyond that?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Unlike a lot of us who were just here experimenting with art and our voice as artists, Basquiat knew early on, before any of us, that he was going to be famous.
And famous he became. Since his death in 1988 at age 27 from a heroin overdose, Basquiat's reputation and the demand for his work have skyrocketed. His now iconic lines, figures, and handwritten texts are regularly displayed in the world's most renowned museums and galleries.
91 million now.
2 years ago, his untitled 1982 painting of a skull fetched more than $110 million at auction, the most ever for any American artist. That work and many others were part of a new exhibition that began in Paris, curated by Dieter Buchart.
His energy is amazing. His line is inimitable. His combination with words, collage, and assemblage, nobody else did. It's all under his own aesthetic. But the way he combined knowledge is so contemporary.
Now the exhibition has come home, in a sense, to Basquiat's old stomping grounds in the East Village of New York, in a brand new private museum owned by the Brandt Foundation. It's housed in a former electrical substation. Tickets here are free. The first batch of 50,000 was gone before the exhibition opened. The works themselves come from museums around the world and private collections, including that of the foundation's founder, Peter Brandt, CEO of one of the largest newsprint manufacturers in North America. He's been buying Basquiat's work since the 1980s.
What did you see in the art at that time?
I thought he was, you know, great colorist. I love the way he used language in his work. And, you know, he'd been billed as a graffiti artist, but if you look at his work, it goes, you know, far beyond painting on subway cars.
Born in Brooklyn in 1960, Basquiat was the son of a Haitian father and Puerto Rican mother. He left home as a teenager and began selling hand-painted postcards and T-shirts. In 1979, he and Holman helped form the rock band Gray, as Basquiat entered a prolific period of creating his own art. Years later, Holman would help capture those times as a screenwriter for the feature film Basquiat, directed by another well-known contemporary artist, Julian Schnabel. Some called Basquiat's paintings primitive, raw, even childlike, but he was unfazed.
He also recognized that combining that child's hand and that child's innocence with some of the highly charged issues of race and economic disparity and the particular politics of America, if he would combine those things in a special way, which he did, that he would touch on that third rail.
The Brandt exhibition reflects those issues in paintings like The Irony of a Negro Policeman and Per Capita. But there are also lighter pieces, like those of famous boxers he admired. Just as Basquiat's prices have gone up, so have rents in the East Village. It and this city have changed dramatically since his time. Further evidence, the Brandt Foundation Museum itself.
He had an aesthetic of the streets. Is there not a disconnect with seeing him in a sold for $110 million, owned by people of wealth, and, you know, in a private museum?
I don't see any disconnect other than it's an example of the American dream. He's not an artist that's just appreciated by the people that live in this neighborhood. We're just giving the people in this neighborhood an opportunity to see the work of somebody that came out of this neighborhood.
Today, Basquiat continues to be a hero for many, including young people like these who stopped to hear our conversation.
Being friends with him, hanging out with him, was like going to Basquiat University, where you gleaned the power of combining disparate ideas that shouldn't work together, but that do.
Jean-Michel Basquiat, the inaugural exhibition at the Brandt Foundation, runs through May 15th. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jeffrey Brown in New York.
Another exhibition showcasing Basquiat's work is set to open at the Solomon R. Guggenheim Museum in New York next month. And that's the NewsHour for tonight. A reminder, tune in tomorrow for Judy's interview with Democratic presidential candidate Senator Bernie Sanders. I'm William Brangham. Join us online and again here tomorrow evening. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you and good night.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
Babbel, a language program that teaches real-life conversations in a new language, such as Spanish, French, German, Italian, and more. Babbel's 10 to 15-minute lessons are available as an app or online. More information on Babbel.com.
Financial services firm, Raymond James. BNSF Railway. Consumer Cellular.
And by the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation, supporting science, technology, and improved economic performance and financial literacy in the 21st century.
Supported by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, committed to building a more just, verdant, and peaceful world. More information at macfound.org. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
PBS.